Okay.
We'll leave this going.
Yeah, back in 20 minutes.
Professor Norman Finkelstein is not only Jewish, his mom and dad are Holocaust survivors. And he's written many books on Israeli Palestinian issue. How much more Jewish could you be than if your mom and dad were Holocaust survivors? And he just is defamed by the
Can I turn the live stream to you guys while you're talking about it? Because we don't have anything interesting to film right now.
Sorry, what?
Can I point the camera at you guys while you're having this discussion? Is that cool?
Yeah, that's fine.
I was just going to say the thing that nobody mentioned was the boycott, divest, sanction movement. It was getting a lot of traction, and that's been a good alternative strategy.
So much more to bring up, but
yeah.
It's hard to bring up everything with the time.
Yeah.
I wanted to make sure I bring the sources so people can hear the sources.
That was really good. Totally. This is kind of funny. Wait, I'll turn it down here. Yeah, I actually registered apacsucks.com. Nobody got that domain name. I get it. So I just have a message from Gaza Youth Breakout posted on there. But yeah, got any clever ideas to what to put on there? Let me know.
That's why I brought up the documentary Five Broken Camels.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I want to see that. Yeah, I've been meaning to.
It's proof for your own eyes.
Yeah.
Small town called Belayim.
Mm-hmm.
Villages. Yeah. Just simply protesting with activists from Germany, France, the U.S. Yeah. Nonviolent, no weapons. See with your own eyes. This was filmed over years. Just simply standing by the fence saying, hey, we want to get to the other side of our land and farms. Just really showed you shooting them.
There was a YouTube video, and again, I mean, you just have to assume what you're seeing, but it had the time and date. It was a sniper rifle with the camera attached to it. And it was in the greatest sniper rifle shooting American soldiers.
Yeah.
And there was like 60. It was posted on Veterans Today.
Oh, yeah. I remember that one, yeah.
And where you're seeing a guy directing traffic and also headshot. And the guy's in a Humvee, headshot. Boom, 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 boom. You know, and again, can you trust? You know, people have no idea the level of psyops that occur in their daily lives. They pick up the city pages and say, oh, this must be not biased. Listen, I'm on AM950 every day. And I know the new order now. I'm trying to make them progressive, but I'll talk to the producers about getting you on.
That would be great.
So if you get a call from Ian Levitt or William Davis, and I'm Mark. I'm going to be the speaker at 12:35. Yeah. We've been around together.
That would be great.
And I'm trying to tell them, listen, jackass, the money's in the middle. You came to the fringes, okay? You've got Fox listeners on the right side.
Mic check!
But most of the people...
Mic check! All you occupiers out there, I gotta ask you a question. The donation bucket that went round, where the hell is it?
It's over there on the table.
Yeah, and it's empty, that's why I'm asking.
That money was put in the metal bucket by the door.
Well,
the money was put in the metal bucket by the door.
Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
No. Okay, right. I hope there's no money.
There they are.
Hey, Mike. Mike.
Coming.
Yeah. Technical whiz. Could you help me set up this projector for the PowerPoint?
Sure.
I don't even know how to do this, so you are the guy that.
Right,
that's
right.
Where's your laptop?
So, do I plug it into an outlet?
Yeah, we'll just put it over there.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay, cool.
I'll talk to Sam.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
I could
set this up. This one doesn't work with the projector, so I can actually unplug.
So I'll get this.
How many? We need two for this stuff. I don't need to be plugged in.
Okay, well, we got two down here.
No, I was gonna. We gotta move.
Right.
Right.
but then I asked people and they say, oh, the projector seems to work fine for us.
Yeah.
I don't know what the deal is on that. It's funny, if it's the projector, why is the click to add notes so clear? You know, no ghosting on that.
That's a good question.
Yeah.
It's good on this side, isn't it? Yeah. Falls apart.
Well, you just stand by the screen there and try to push things together, okay?
Yeah, I'll do that.
That's what we need technical experts for. So if you figure that out, let me know what it is.
Yeah.
Oh, maybe that's it.
Well, it's like it's a. I don't know exactly how the projection mechanism works, but it seems like the magenta channel is misaligned, basically. So, but it's okay on the left. It's okay over here, and then it just like stretches out. That's the best we can do right now. I don't know.
Not my department.
Yeah.
If it isn't just the
is there a way to pause it?
Projector, if you hit the recycle, the reload one might do it. The circle one. Okay. That might help. And sometimes that does it on mine. It doesn't come all the way through.
Yeah, I this thing has done this to me every time I've used
really?
It lately, so I don't think we're going to get any more. Better than nothing. So I'm gonna adjust the size. It's like the VGA cable has these different pins, you know?
Right, right.
And so if you... The cable seems like it's okay, but it just always kind of looks this way. It just
seems like it's one of the colors is...
But like when I wiggle it, it's the magenta color is either projecting wrong or the pin is bent or something.
Yep.
That doesn't really help. That's the best level of picture I can get with the device. It's got a little interference.
Can you get the mic on again?
Yeah.
Mic check. Mic check!
Mic Kaplan check.
Thank you for all you occupiers out there.
we actually have a couple of minor changes in the agenda, y'all. So, first of all, Jan would like to come up and just speak for a moment and acknowledge a local hero who's in the crowd right now. In amongst a room full of heroes.
Well, Michael, you just said what I was going to say, that we have many heroes here. But I, in particular, have something on my mind, which is a certain stadium that has been foisted upon us by the city council mayor, several stadiums, actually. City council mayor, metropolitan, I mean, whatever, the Hennepin County commissioners, the governor of our state ganged up on us and illegally put this huge burden on us when we really need funds for all things like kids, yeah, and their education. So I just want to recognize somebody in our midst. There are a number of heroes among us, but in particular, I just wanted to say that Doug Mann is here, a wonderful gentleman who has brought two lawsuits which did reveal that they have no answers for us. The first one he brought did bring to light Susan Siegel, who's a city attorney, the decision was that she gave the city bad legal advice, and she is currently up for reappointment. And the second lawsuit just basically was dismissed on for one thing, the opposition demanded something like, what was it, $50 million or some absurd sum that he would have to put, for possible harm to their, their whatever, their action, their trying to get this stadium done on time. And we're always in a hurry to rush these things through because, because we're doing something totally illegal, and that's how they frame it. Everybody just, they're going at warp speed, and no time for the public to give their input. So anyway, but his second lawsuit did bring fruit in that it was basically dismissed. He was told that he needed to have done this in another venue, I could let him explain it, but at any rate, there was no solid evidence that. Well, the evidence was more pointing up the fact that they had no answer for his questions, and he possibly may continue to pursue this. And this is a huge thing on my mind because this city of Minneapolis is falling apart under very, very bad leadership, and it's right down there at City Hall. So, thanks, Doug.
Whoop, whoop. Okay, no, we are not going to go to the discussions part yet, you guys. I've seen all these hands going up. Bunch of lefties want to speak. Don't worry, you'll have lots of time to speak. We're going to make a slight adjustment in the program here. Eric Morrison actually has to leave early. And I'm going to give you a little bit of a backdrop on Eric. Eric is a member of my church. Which tribe do you belong to, Eric?
I don't.
He's an unaffiliated native. He comes to our church. And Eric actually spoke at the PolyMed hearing and did a wonderful factual presentation on on how the PolyMed mine, which is being supported by the establishment, is going to contaminate the boundary waters, which is a natural treasure for us in Minnesota. So I want to give you very quickly Eric Morrison speaking on the boundary waters and contamination. Thank you.
Give it up, folks.
Yay.
Okay, just a second.
It'll change by itself, but if it doesn't.
Okay, so I'm. My name is Eric Morrison, and I have a degree in chemistry, so a lot of people ask me to look at the environmental impact statement for the power plant. And it seems pretty much of a. It's kind of a hard thing for me to do because I'm looking at what's happening in the world today, and I've become concerned. I'm gonna just start this slide back again. Start it back at the beginning.
What I wanted to do is
put my comments into context, because this is a new thing for me to kind of take this interest in the environment. I will tell you that I've been going to the boundary waters since I was a small boy, and I've been there many times. And so I come to this conversation from having been to the boundary waters a lot of time. But the thing that really has been on my mind for a long time is that, you know, 20 years ago or more, the engine light went off on this car that we're driving down the freeway. And what the engine light was the elevated carbon dioxide levels. That's shown here.
It's like not like it's.
Are you touching anything?
No, it's like. I'm not sure if you want to get some information.
Okay, so no, don't touch anything unless I ask you to. Okay, so 20 years ago, the light went off in a car, and that light was that the carbon dioxide levels were rising.
And what we find is that 20 years ago, people told us, no, don't pay attention to that. You're not qualified. You don't have the education. You don't have the sense to understand what those carbon dioxide levels mean. And then a little bit longer down the road, what happened is the car started to act up because that carbon dioxide warning light said that the engine's going to start overheating, and we've started to see that happen. And while we're sitting here driving this car down the road, what's happening is, and so there's, you can see the engine light came on about 30 years ago, said carbon dioxide levels are rising and that the temperature is going to follow. And sure enough, the temperature is falling. So now the car is starting to make some noise, and there's some pounding in the engine, and we've got hurricanes and natural disasters increasing. But we have a passenger in this car, and the passenger is the bankers, and they tell us that you have to go 3% faster year on year. So I've been working in industry for a long time, and I hear that we have to have that 3% growth. And this shows how the carbon dioxide emissions and the gross world product is, like we used to call it, gross domestic product. We've got the bankers in that car, and they're telling us you have to go 3% faster. And here's one of the ways we're going to go faster, is with Polymet. And I left Ecolab about a year ago because Ecolab grew up on cleaning and sanitation and making the world a cleaner, safer, healthier place, but they found out since then, they determined in about 2008, let's stop it right here.
Okay.
If we can pause it somehow. Yeah, okay, and then just, when we get going again, honey,
mm-hmm.
All you gotta do is push it right here, there's this little thing right there.
Yeah.
And just push it.
And so, in Ecolab in 2008,
there was a stock buyback. Ecolab bought back 30% of the company. They got the money from Switzerland. They got a Swiss executive. That Swiss executive came to Ecolab and he taught them a few tricks. One of them is that there's a better thing to do with soap than clean stuff like that. And I like working at Ecolab because, in fact, cleaning is one of the most sincere forms of, there's an Ecolab dishwasher out there. It's one of the most sincere forms of recycling you can have. It's a humble profession making soap, but it's a good one. But there's a better use for soap if you're worried about money, and that is it's good for fracking. So in 2008, Ecolab got money from someplace to buy back 30% of the company. They had a joint venture in Europe with Henkel. And they bought their share back from Henkel with 30%. They got the money somewhere. And then they got a change in direction, which is buying up energy companies. So the first company that Ecolab bought was Nalco, which is the company that made the dispersants for the Gulf oil spill. And then about a year ago, they closed on buying Champion. And so they're going to be addressing their attention to, you know, fracking and enhanced oil recovery and that type of thing. And I don't have a problem with that per se, except that Ecolab's position on this is called abundant energy. And Ecolab notes on their website, if you go look at it, that humanity's burned 1 trillion barrels of oil so far. They're going to burn another 2 trillion before we're done. And that's with the engine light on the car coming on and you know, some problems coming from under the hood. Because they're in that driver's seat is the bankers, I'm thinking, that says you have to go 3% faster year on year. I know working at Ecolab, you have to go 3% faster year on year. Well, Ecolab didn't care much for me either because I was working on enzymatic cleaning, which could use less water and return water to the environment that wasn't so toxic and caustic. But that's not a lot of interest. It might be economically viable, but it's not like the soap business could be. So anyways, I have been working, trying to find other gooder, better things to do that are a little more thoughtful. Anyways, that being said, I was doing something I thought was better until this PolyMet situation came up. And so that, if you hit that button, we'll just talk a little bit about PolyMet, and then I'll be gone. Okay, so PolyMet, you saw the big banner, the 3% faster year-on-year is going to come from putting a mine. The mine is that magenta outline right there. The mine is right next to this yellow body of water that's outlined to the north of it. That yellow body is called the 100-mile swamp. And the 100-mile swamp, as you can see here, it drains to the north, to the Dunkle River, and then into Birch Lake, which is the lake up there. And the problem with that is that the Birch Lake drains to the Kuwishwe River and goes to the Boundary Waters. And that's bad enough. They're going to be putting other mines up there in the Boundary Waters, but this is the one that's going to open a door for that. And the way it's going to do it is to make people think that it's not going to the Boundary Waters. So what they did in the environmental impact statement is they drew a different map for the swamp. They didn't put the yellow outline in there that the government maps would have. They put this blue outline there. And then they tell everybody, the environmental impact statement, if you read it carefully, does not say that mine waste will not go to Boundary Waters. It never says that. It makes you, you know, it insinuates that. And then you read to believe that, but they never come out and verbatim state that mine waste won't go to Boundary Waters. Where people would yell and scream at me and tell me, are you an idiot? You are an idiot. Because you're not a hydrologist. You can't read a map. But you can look at these maps and you can tell, and this is the map outlines that's done in a program called GIS. And it shows the outline, the yellow of the 100-mile swamp. This is using GPS waypoints. It shows the blue, the swamp as they drew it. And it shows the mine site, and the black line is a continental divide. So you can look at the GPS waypoints and you can tell. It's hard to find that information, but if you find it, you can tell it. They've redrawn the map. one of the things that people say, well, all the water's going down, there's two rivers that drain that swamp, it's all going down the Partridge River. And what these slides here show, I think you can just hit this button. No, not that one. Hit this one right here, the down button. Yep. Okay. As you look at that Partridge River that's supposed to drain all this water away, this is what it looks like, keep on, as you zoom in on it. As you get a real good close look at it, you see that this river actually disappears into the 100-mile swamp. So a hydrologist that I talked to said, well, you got to think about the exchange of water with this Partridge River and the 100-mile swamp. Well, yeah, you can figure it out pretty easily, all the water exchanges, because at some point there is no river, it's all in the swamp. And part of the swamp is going to be drained by the Partridge River down here at the bottom, but the rest of it's going to be drained up there. And the groundwater contours is in the next slide, I think. Go ahead and hit that again.
The down one?
Yep, the down one. This shows groundwater contours there in the blue. They're a little bit hard to see. What do the groundwater contours say that is in that swamp? The flow of groundwater is to the northeast. Some of it will go down the river that's in the south, but the groundwater flow direction is in the northeast. This is what they don't want you to know. And this is what it says in the environmental impact statement. It has three sentences there. It says that the North Met Project drains to the Partridge River. It says the Partridge River is a tributary to the St. Louis River. Hit the outline if you can. Okay. It says that the Partridge River is where the waste is going. It says that the Partridge River is already is going down the St. Louis River. It says the St. Louis River is not in the Hudson Bay watershed. It's not going to the boundary waters. All those things are true. The punchline is that there's a second drainage site from this mine site, which is the boundary waters. Okay, next one. So here's the problem with this environmental impact statement. They'll tell you that they spent $50 million on it and that they've spent since 1998 working on it. That may be true, but these are the problems. There's a problem with the geography, it's incorrect. Hit the up again. The hydrology is incorrect. They didn't measure the hydrology. If they are going to say that that water isn't going to get to the boundary waters, they should have done two well testing to put dye in one well and see how fast it goes across and where it goes in that swamp. They didn't do that. There's organizational issues. PolyMet only exists, the corporation PolyMet only exists for the purposes of getting the nickel and copper out of that mine. That's all the company's set up for. It's never done anything else. It will never do anything else. It's currently owned 34% by Glencore Estrada, and you can see what their labor and human rights track record is, and you can see what their environmental track record is. They're going to be moving up to 42% ownership in the fully diluted company. It gives them the ownership, but it gives them walk-away capability so that when they've got the minerals out, they can just leave because they don't own it. It's not a more than half-owned subsidiary. So the financial issues here are that it will take $6 million by their estimate to clean up what water they can collect from the waste. That means that to do that $6 million worth of water treatment for 500 years or 300 years or 200 years or whatever, it's definitely going to be centuries. It at 1.38%, which is the current rate on government I-bonds right now, it requires $435 million in principal plus a couple $100 million to not really restore the site, but close the mine down. And in spite of this, in that environmental impact statement, there are less than three pages that talk about financial bonds or financial assurance. These are some problems with this environmental impact statement. So even though it's been around for many years and they've spent a lot of money on it, these problems work for the mining company. They do not work for the people. These are things that people don't want you to know. Okay, and I think the last slide here is what you can do about it. I've tried to talk to people, at environmental groups, but environmental groups have kind of are aligned with the money. Friends of the Boundary Waters normally won't let you fart in the Boundary Waters.
What happened?
Just hit the up key. They won't even let you have, they want to have no more than 6 people traveling together in the Boundary Waters. They want to diminish the number of quotas in the Boundary Waters so that there's no trampling of the ground. But they're so being so environmentally staunch, they're disagreed with the original environmental impact statement, and they're saying, hey, it looks good now. And the thing is, the person that's in charge of this for the Friends of the Boundary Waters is relatively new to the organization and doesn't even go to the Boundary Waters that much, apparently. So that's not going to work. Talking to the Minnesota Center for Environmental Advocacy, they tell me, okay, we can see the map, but we don't agree that the water's going to go you know, across that 100-mile swamp and drain down the dump the river. You're wasting our time. Go away. They're not going to do this. You know, I might be an idiot. It looks pretty plain to me. But if enough people that have PhDs in hydrology say it's not even worth considering, what are you going to do? I think what we should do is we should demand an environmental impact statement that has the correct geography. I think we have the right to that. I think we have a right as Minnesotans to demand an environmental impact statement that has more than 3 pages on financial assurance for something that's going to be in the better part of $1 billion. I don't think it's going to make a difference, because I think that the public comments is just a setup. But before we can say that the public comment thing is just a setup, there, we have to make those public comments. And it is true that the only public comments that matter are ones that address the technical deficiencies of the environmental impact statement. And most people are afraid to do that. Very few people will even pick up the 2,000 pages and look through it. I think what has to be done here is to try and get enough people to make those technical comments that we can see if they're true to their word, that the public commenting makes a difference. We can see if it's, if we're living in a republic or a democracy, or if it's just a scam. But before we can say it's a scam, I think we have to go to the next step and submit the public comment. So I'm trying to get the word out. It's obviously not going to happen with the Friends of the Boundary Waters. And it doesn't look like it's going to happen through the Minnesota Center for Environmental Advocacy. So I guess that's why I'm here today, is to see if the, you know, get, if it's possible to get some stuff. That's all I have.
By the way, before we start, I just got to let you guys know something, but this so-called idiot has got a PhD in chemistry from Penn State. That's an Ivy League institution. That's not an idiot. That's something to be proud of.
Can I ask you something? What organization,
Diversity
Inc., aware of this? Is Water Legacy, and they've got a website, and they keep people like, do you like the water? Do you have your deckers and your entire clean tire?
I think that's important here is not to rely on the Water Legacy or the Friends of the Boundary Waters, because it's hard to tell who's thinking what. And I know Deidre, and I know Jennifer Hengelfeld that's working there too. I've known Jennifer for a long time. And you know, they are in earnest about this. But I think what's happened is the Minnesota Center for Environmental Advocacy and the Water Legacy Group and the Friends of the Boundary Waters all have the same hydrologist, and he's an expert witness. And I'm just thinking that it's just one guy that they're all going to, and his name is Tom Myers, and he's kind of worked as kind of that devil's advocate role for the mining company for years and years. And so he's a guy that says that the water flow data is off by a factor of 3, and you know, Polymer's easily be able to address that issue because they say that their models can encompass a 3-fold inaccuracy in the water flow rates. So it might be that this guy, you know, is playing a devil's advocate role and saying, hey, the water flow is wrong. This is more consequential. because the water flow to the boundary waters, yes or no? Did they rewrite the maps, yes or no? This is a lot more difficult question. A hydrologist that I talked to over in Menominee has no skin in the game whatsoever. He's retired. He did work for mines. He said that what they have to do to understand the water flow in that 100-mile swamp is they have to put two well tests in there. You put a well in one place, put dye in there, and you see they come out someplace else. They didn't do that. And so, you know, this guy, and I'm not sure, I know Tom Myers is one of the hydrologists. He might be the only one that's working as the point counterpoint, but they don't even allow discussion on this topic. And I know I'm not qualified to say what the testing should be. What I'm saying is this environmental impact statement should have a discussion about it. They're asking me to do the same thing. So my my ex-wife, so Mia's mom, always used to do this thing about mechanics. And she said, you know, I can't tell if the mechanic's telling me a line or not. And she's not taking the call. But I think there's some things we can do as people that aren't mechanics ourselves to figure out some strategies to deal with this. So you could get a second opinion from a different mechanic. But she'd always say, I really think this is an honest person. And I'd say, you know, I can't tell one way or the other. And I'm not a mechanic either, so I'd have to use some strategies, get a different mechanic. So the one thing that I like about the mechanic story is, and Mia probably remembers this, she called me at work one day and said, is there something to say mechanic? Is there something that could happen that they change the oil and the wheel falls off the tire? And they had done a brake inspection, even though they did her brakes 3 months before they did brake inspection. They found that her brakes needed to be done again because they forgot that they did it. And they forgot to put the lug nuts back on. I can't tell if the mechanic here, whether it's, you know, their hydrologist or some other hydrologist knows anything, but I can tell you this, there's some strategies for working through these issues that allow you, not being trained in the area, to have some strategies to get it figured out. The least you can do is say, okay, you know, break it down for me, explain it to me like I'm a fifth grader. You should be able to explain that. I didn't have to go to college forever for you to be able to explain to me that stuff.
Okay, now, I'm actually gonna kind of play mini dictator here. Okay. You have a time constraint. No. You find a mechanic that you trust like Dave Bicking is the answer, but anyway. There is gonna be a public session afterwards. Yes, Dave, I'm talking about you. But at this point, we have to keep this on track, and there's a gentleman that I am so excited to hear from, and this guy's a firecracker. And by the way, you son of a bitch, you've got 15 minutes. I will yank you off the stage if I have to.
I dare you.
No, this guy knows the facts, and I called him a federal whistleblower, but he's using a whole different term that I love the way he frames this. This guy knows exactly how corrupt our government is and just where the corruption goes and who's playing along.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Okay. Martin Nowitzki, come up here, man.
Okay. I'm a prop comic. This is blue Kool-Aid and this is red Kool-Aid. We ain't drinking any Kool-Aid here. Now, my name is Mark Nowitzki. I'm a an international whistleblower on security issues in relation to financial fraud and corruption throughout the world, and illegal government domestic surveillance, especially done through private contractors. And before I begin that, I'd like to have a moment of silence. Because this is the 100th anniversary of the overthrow of the United States government. It was overthrown by a foreign occupying force called the Federal Reserve. And if anybody knows anything about the Federal Reserve, you'd understand and appreciate that it is not federal, nor does it have any reserve. In fact, you can look at YouTube and read where Congressman Alan Grayson, an actual progressive, got the Inspector General of the Federal Reserve to admit that they cannot track $9 trillion. They lost track of $9 trillion. So I'm going to go back to George W. Bush and say, remember the WMD joke? Where's that $9 trillion? Anybody seen that $9 trillion? How do you lose $9 trillion? You don't lose $9 trillion. I say, people in Wall Street and stock, you don't lose that money. It's transferred. Okay. Now, during the break, I put something under everybody's seat, so if you just want to pull out your tinfoil hat. No, seriously. What are you guys doing here? What are you doing? The Olympics are on. Don't you know? Honey Boo Boo's hillbilly hand fishing. Don't you have anything better to do? No. You guys are critical thinkers. You're capable of complex reasoning. But you have combined that with compassion. That's why you're here. Because, you know, again, we do this for the greater good. And that's why, because nobody else is doing it. People say, Mark, what are you, you know, how long are you going to do? Somebody's got to do it, and I'm going to do it until I'm done. What are you going to quit? Now, I'm also going to open up with another joke, and this is observational humor. Politicians are a lot like diapers. They need to be changed a lot for the exact same reason. Here's another joke. Call your congressman. Now, my epitaph would read, and my son Nick is here, George Orwell, in a time of universal deceit, telling the truth becomes a revolutionary act. I think George Orwell would look at the United States and say, are you shitting me? Voltaire is another great quote. It's dangerous to be right when the government is wrong. And the problem that we've got here is that Samuel Goldwyn, the movie producer from the 20s, he said, the most important thing about acting is honesty. And if you can fake that, you got it made. I think he was talking about politics. So when Yes We Can turned into Yes We Scan, and Hope and Change meet, come on. Are you going to fall for that crap again? This is what Nietzsche says about hope and change. Hope in reality is the worst of all evils because it prolongs the torments of man. You're hoping your hope has power. And that's why you're here. Engage your brain. Engage your legs. Get other people to show up. I'm happy about this. I'm on AM 950 just about every morning. I'm Mark Pridley. And I'm trying to drag them into becoming a little bit more progressive. Okay? But, again, God bless them. You know, there's no such thing as a moderate progressive. We have moderate Democrats. Okay, what do you think of when you hear a moderate Democrat? Republican. We have neoliberals. Okay, nobody's got your back. The only time a politician has your back is when he's doing this. Now, Paul Wellstone. Okay, I shared the dance with Colleen Rowley a couple of years ago at the 10th anniversary of the death of Paul Wellstone. We invited all of the progressive liberal groups to show up to that event, and they didn't show up. I met with them, and at first they were excited because I was setting them up. I said, we're going to put on an event at the Wellstone Center. We've got the whole gymnasium, and it's going to be Colleen Rowley, it's going to be Dr. Jim Fetzer, and it's going to be myself. And we're going to commemorate the life and accomplishments and the death of Paul Wellstone, his wife Sheila, his daughter, the three staffers, and the two pilots. And they said, great, what can we do? And I said, well, put it in park for a sec. We're also going to call for an investigation into the death of Paul Wellstone. That we don't buy what the FBI sold us. We don't buy what the National Transportation Safety sold us. This guy was assassinated in broad daylight. Now, I'm a national security whistleblower. They don't have to kill you to kill you. And we've known this for a very, very, very long time. And I'm going to give you some quotes. And I like to do a thing. It's called using history and facts. So a politician can come out and say all kinds of pretty words. How many people watch the State of the Union address? Okay. If you did, basically everything that Barack Obama said was categorically untrue. So if you're talking about increasing the living standards for the American people and creating jobs and you know, minimum wage. But then you're jamming the Trans-Pacific Partnership down the people's back, down their throat, trying to do it in secret, trying to do it in subversive to the separation of powers and the role of Congress. Not letting any, the only people that get to see this thing apparently are the corporations that are controlling it. But Paul Wellstone said the Democratic Party has lost much of its credibility with the working class and low-income people. It retards progress towards presenting a genuine alternative. So he said that in 2001. He knew what he was doing. And also, Will Rogers says, I'm not a member of any organized political party. I'm a Democrat. So this is, we're under attack. In case you haven't noticed, our country is overrun and dominated by massive systemic corruption. We got the red team and the blue team that are on the same team, the same owners, backing both sides. That's a win-win for them. Very easy to understand if you're paying attention. That's the smart play. And as long as people remain distracted, divided, in denial, apathetic, deliberately tuning it out, and you're looking to your teleprompter reader or your hot sheet repeater as your news service or you know, reading the New York Times, information is something they give you. Knowledge is something you acquire. And so one of the biggest problems we have here today is what Abraham Lincoln talked about. I'm a firm believer in the people. If given the truth, they can be depended upon to meet any national crisis. The great point is to bring them the real facts. That's a problem. The people aren't getting the real facts. And can we hope that if they do get the real facts, that they're going to look around like the people in this room and understand and realize that if it's going to be, it's up to me. Now, I hope you didn't come here for some truth. The key to a functioning democracy that actually works is having an informed and engaged electorate. That doesn't mean voting once every 4 years. And if we look at our system today, it's more like a cult. You know, the lesser of two evils is still evil. And, a neoliberal, look, we fell for it. We keep falling for it. We keep falling for it. And you know what? It's time to tell the Democratic Party, you had your shot. It's our turn now. We want a progressive. And, you know, and I want to get to this quickly. How much time do I got? Okay. I want to get back to my history on being a national security whistleblower. Okay. I worked for a corporate, and again, I've been interviewed by 60 Minutes, senior executive producer Bob Anderson. I've been interviewed by the New York Times, Gretchen Morgans, Pulitzer Prize winner. I've been interviewed by Dana Priest, Washington Post, Pulitzer Prize winner, and she stole her story that she won the Pulitzer Prize basically from me, which was called Top Secret America. Thanks a lot for that, Dana. Ian McKenzie from the BBC, the Star Tribune, and they looked at me and they said, I can't believe, how do you know all this stuff? Because I lived it. And then to a group, all of them fell off the face of the earth. At least Gretchen Morgenson from the New York Times had, she called me back and she said, Mark, I'm sorry, but my editor is pulling the story. There's nothing I can do. I'm sorry. And then hung up on me. That's media. You know what my acronym is for media? Making everyone dumber in America. You can substitute destitute and dead, but dumber. Now, I work for a company called Teletech Holdings, a multi-billion dollar international telecommunications IT, electronic customer relations management company, headquartered out of Denver, Colorado. I work for a subsidiary that worked within the retail automobile industry, so we had contracts with just about every manufacturer and every dealer in the country. And what we were doing is we were managing their database. We were sending out information to their customer base, and we were following what they were doing and when they were buying and when they were coming in and where they live and what their income was, and which is dangerous. Now, I know a lot, and I have educated Keith Ellison, and I have educated Al Franken. to a degree. Now, again, how many, raise your hands if you know Ed Snowden. Anybody heard of Ed Snowden in the room? How about Russell Tice, anybody? How about William Binney? How about Thomas Drake? How about Chris Pyle? Okay, these are people that actually worked at the NSA when Ed Snowden was pretty much in high school, saying the same thing. But what Ed Snowden did is he understood what was going to happen to him, okay? Now, I know a lot of dead whistleblowers, Michael Hastings, okay, Aaron Swartz, Mike Connell, Colonel Ted Westhusing. We could go on for a weekend seminar of these dead whistleblowers. We could also talk about, you know, if you people understood how many honest, well-intended people, there's a little brochure out here about two cops from Crystal that were fired for doing the right thing. Okay, you don't think that that happens at the top? That's, it starts at the top, baby. Okay, so whistleblowers, with all due respect to crab fishermen and even our military and police, being a whistleblower is the world's most dangerous profession. And we had a president who said, we're going to take care of these whistleblowers and we're going to be the most open and transparent, you know. Bullshit! I mean, how long did it take? You know, for people to understand that, you know, we were sold a bill of goods. This is a Trojan horse. Okay, he said all the right words, but nothing has happened. So anyway, you know, again, giving me 15 minutes is like giving a sumo wrestler a Triscuit. Now the other thing is I took like a good whistleblower. I went to the FBI, they screwed me over. I went to the SEC, they screwed me over. Okay, I was a whistleblower in 2007 that brought to the attention that there was a hotline into the SEC to stop or stall investigations. I've got information in the public, in the federal court record, in the SEC record, in the FBI record, in the congressional record. The 2008 crisis was not only preventable, it was created. And I can prove that with congressional documents. If you saw what I had, and I took this to all of the media, and I said, Sarbanes-Oxley, that's a joke. That's destined to fail. Sarbanes-Oxley was implemented in institution as was a complete fraud because it had two major loopholes. Number one, it didn't allow for punitive damage awards, so you couldn't get a lawyer to represent you. And number, you know, so, and you weren't entitled to a trial by jury. So basically, Sarbanes-Oxley was set up to fail. Nobody was asking in the media, well, why do we have this crisis? We were told Sarbanes-Oxley. Then we got Dodd-Frank. Okay, Dodd-Frank should be changed to Frank Dodd so we can shorten it to fraud, because that's what it really was. Now, with me, I know my time is running short. I was telling people 10 years ago that everything you do is being monitored, watched, and recorded. Now, I'm going to read something quick. Okay, see if you can tell me, if you know who said this, a senior Barack Obama official, and when. It reads, another threat, less overt, but no less basic, confronts liberal democracy. More directly linked to the impact of technology, it involves the gradual appearance of a more controlled society. Such a society would be dominated by an elite whose claim to political power would rest on allegedly superior scientific know-how. Unhindered by the restraints of traditional liberal values, this elite would not hesitate to achieve its political ends by using the latest modern techniques for influencing public behavior and keeping society under close surveillance and control. Well, you know, I know you know that. That was Zbigniew Brzezinski in 1968. Okay, your smartphone, your internet, your GPS, okay, my company Teletech has got a direct link to DARPA. The Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. Okay, so all of my former employer, Teletech, has got metadata on all of you. And there's a back door that goes right to the government. So your health care information, your employment history, your library information, your retail information, all of this. And if you know, if they were talking about this in 1968, Now, this is another thing Ziggy said. He said, at the same time, the capacity to assert social and political control over the individual will vastly increase. As I've already noted, it will soon be possible to assert almost continuous surveillance over every citizen and to maintain up-to-date, complete files containing even the most personal information about the health or personal behavior of the citizen, in addition to more customary data. These files will be subject to instantaneous retrieval by the authorities. That was from Brzezinski's book, America in a Technotronic Age in 1968. Okay, remember 1968? Did we have a cassette player? Were there cell phones in 68? So in 19, well, I understand, but I went to, and I had hours and hours and hours and hours of meetings with senior staffers from Keith Ellison's office and Al Franken's office. Now, Al Franken, again, is the Senate Judiciary Subcommittee Chairman for Privacy and Technology and the Law. And he recently said this, but I can assure you, this isn't about spying on the American people. And then he also said, which is what Bernie Sanders found out, that, and I'm paraphrasing, he said, if the American people knew what the NSA was doing, and I told you, I would be arrested. So if a senator in charge of the Senate Judiciary Subcommittee for Privacy, Technology, and Law who told the American people what was really happening was going to be arrested, what do you think our chances are? Okay? Take this information, engage your brain, engage your feet, engage your, you know, and applaud you guys for being here. Thanks very much for the time.
Thank you, Mark. And just as a personal commentary with Mark, and just as for all of you out there who knew about a co-chair of the Progressive Caucus of the Democratic Party, Keith Ellison, Mark told Keith Ellison about the Trans-Pacific Partnership 2 years before Keith Ellison went public about it. Keith Ellison went public about it when it was too late for us to do something about it. Remember that. And that's a fact.
I just need, okay, you know who's in charge of the country? A reading from the book of Tom Hartman, page 86. Okay, this was a BBC documentary film called The Trap, and I'm reading from Tom's book. A few weeks before Bill Clinton was to take the oath of office, he was paid a little visit by two notorious royalists, the CEO of Goldman Sachs at the time, Robert Rubin, who had become his Bill Clinton's Treasury Secretary, and Alan Greenspan, the chairman of the Federal Reserve. Rubin and Greenspan sat the young president down and explained to him that the royalists were in charge. That's who we vote for president. And in closing, I wish I've got a picture here of Jamie Dimon, JP Morgan Bank. He just got a $20 million bump in his pay, and his corporation was fined $20 billion. And this is why Holder is resigning. I could go on about that. But this is a picture from Reuters taken 2 years ago at the congressional hearings when they were called in front of the hearings. And he's got these massive cufflinks on. They're about the size of a silver dollar. And they have the symbol of the president and the seal of the president of the United States. And he's sitting there at his desk looking at the congressman with his cufflinks saying, don't mess with me. I'm the boss. The bankers are the boss. Whether the red or blue team is in charge, the left and the right fight, guns got gays, but the bankers are in charge.
Very, very heavy stuff, and I'm going to add on a very quick thing to that. And I'm speaking from personal observation, from experience living in Northern Ireland, where this surveillance society was perfected in Belfast. Remember this, they watch us, resistance still always finds a way, and never forget that. So, we're actually going to have the next group of speakers. They're all kind of speaking on the same topic. It's on the issue of the living wage, an actual real living wage, and the $15 campaign. So we're going to start off with Alan Mackey. He's going to be followed by Leanna Gale, and then Ty Moore. So let's start off with Alan Mackey, the Casino Workers Union organizer. Alan, get up here. A more ballsy guy you'll never find in this guy. Let me tell you that right now.
Well, I'd like to talk about the minimum wage. I think as progressives, we got to strike while the iron is hot. And I think this is key, and we haven't been doing that. Progressives haven't been doing very well over the last several decades as far as winning the battles we've been involved in. And I think that a large part of that is because we haven't learned to strike while the iron is hot. And that's what we got to begin to do. I think we got to begin to, a lot of people have talked about this, connect the dots so we understand that all of our struggles are interrelated. One of the things I'm going to be talking about in addition to the minimum wage is the 21st Century Full Employment Act for Peace and Prosperity. Bob Herbert from the New York Times, he used to be from the New York Times, a columnist with the New York Times, said, the U.S. has not just misplaced its priorities. When the most powerful country ever to inhabit the earth finds it so easy to plunge into the horror of warfare, but almost impossible to find adequate work for its people or to properly educate its young, it has lost its way entirely. And I think probably that's why we're all here today. I'd also like to talk about the basic income guarantee. Thomas Paine talked about this back in 1797 in a pamphlet that he put out, because the minimum wage isn't the total solution. And a basic income guarantee and the minimum wage aren't a total solution. What we need is a 21st Century Full Employment Act for Peace and Prosperity, which would make the President of the United States and the Congress of the United States work together to ensure, to attain, and maintain full employment in this country. That is not too much to ask, living in the richest and wealthiest country in the world, that everybody have a job at real living wages. You know, the rich, they've created the poor, but now they don't want to look at the poor. And why are people poor? Well, think about it. People paid poverty wages. Aren't they going to be poor? Isn't that common sense? Any school child understands this. Working people without jobs. Aren't they going to be poor? And yet we have politicians undertaking these so-called studies, spending millions of dollars to find out why people are living in poverty, and they can't figure out that people paid poverty wages are going to be poor. They can't figure out that working people without jobs are going to be poor. Common sense. And yet these committees that they hire, these think tanks that they hire, can never figure this out. Basic common sense. You know, when we talk about the minimum wage, we have to talk about, because some people are getting paid poverty wages, other people are becoming extremely rich and wealthy. They're reaping super profits as the result of paying people poverty wages. Think about it. Why should anybody have to do any job in this country and not be able to cover the cost of living? You know, working people, what do they have when we talk about cost of living? Don't we have to relate wages to cost of living? What other relationship is there besides the relationship between wages and cost of living? Yet none of these people want to talk about this. None of the politicians want to talk about cost of living. Some will talk about the influence of inflation on wages. Some will talk about these CEOs reaping millions and even billions of dollars and bonuses and salaries and everything else. But really, we're living in a capitalist society. Don't we sort of expect these people at the top to get this extreme wealth? But what we're not talking about is that the workers who create this wealth are not even receiving wages that allow them to meet their basic standard of living, the cost of living. You know, this is it's not as immoral, and it's wrong. You know, a lot of people don't want to talk about redistribution of wealth. You know, on the other hand, other people, like even Obama, talk about sometimes the redistribution of wealth. But when we talk about redistribution of wealth, we have to talk about raising wages to real living wages. That's what redistribution of wealth is really all about. A couple things I'd like to mention. The United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights. This is a document that Eleanor Roosevelt and a number of people like Francis Perkins and progressives from all over the world developed, United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights.
And let me just read what it says in Article 23. Everyone has the right to work, to free choice of employment, to just and favorable conditions of work, and to protection against unemployment. Everyone, without discrimination, has the right to equal pay for equal work. Everyone who works has the right to just and favorable remuneration for ensuring for himself and his family an existence worthy of human dignity. Here we are in the richest country in the world. How many people can say they have any of this? This document was brought into existence in 1948. You know, the politicians in this country, people like Dayton and all these people, these Democratic Party hacks, tell us we should be satisfied with incremental reforms and that we should go slow because it's going to upset the economy if workers are paid real living wages. You know, this is just plain wrong. You know, now they want to foist a minimum wage of $9.50 an hour upon us. Like many of you, I've been getting things in the mail from all these outfits that are fronts for the DFL. It says, raise the wage by $9.50 by 2015. I'll tell you, Mark Dayton came begging to me in front of over 200 people for my support, and one of the things that he said he was for is a living wage. Now he's pushing this $9.50 minimum wage. That is not a living wage. Nobody can live on it. And what he's not saying is that most people that are getting paid these poverty wages only work part-time. Very few get 40 hours a week. You know, how is that a living wage? Right, it's Alan, not.
Tell the truth, Alan.
And so all these DFL caucuses, we brought resolutions before a number of precinct caucuses saying that the minimum wage should be legislatively tied to the cost of living. Because the United States Department of Labor, Bureau of Labor Statistics, tracks in 8 categories and 207 subcategories every single thing that we purchase. So they know what the cost of living is. The United States government is like a crooked and corrupt employer. They keep one set of books to show the union, another set of books to show the IRS, and another set of books for themselves, which shows the real profits. That's what we're dealing with. The United States Census Bureau keeps one set of books. The Bureau of Labor Statistics keeps another set of books. For the, we say that the $15 an hour minimum wage is a good place to start because the United States Census Bureau says that brings people to the poverty line. That's if you work a 40-hour week. Well, if you don't work a 40-hour week, then what? And this is where basic income guarantee comes into play. Cindy Sheehan out in California is making a whole campaign around the basic income guarantee. This is not a far-out idea. I've been told that, you know, you've got far-out left ideas. But this is just plain common sense. We're living in the wealthiest country of the world where the working people have created that wealth. And if you, a working person can't have a job that ensures them a basic living income, there's something drastically wrong.
1 minute.
Only 1 minute left. Well, okay, let me go to a small business deal. We're being told constantly that small businesses will go out of business if they are forced to pay a living wage. I asked State Senator Tom Bach to provide me with one single example of any small business that has gone out of business because of the issue of wages. He told me, I'll get back to you in a couple weeks. That was about 4 months ago. You know, the fact is, small businesses go out of business because they cannot compete with monopolies who fix the prices. Small businesses, one of the main reasons they go out of business is because the partners in those businesses are swindling each other, and you have all this embezzlement taking place, so they go out of business. You look at it in these malls where the shops were there, and now they're not there anymore. What's the reason? High rents. High mortgages. This is why small businesses are going broke. It's a total lie that increasing the minimum wage to a living wage will hurt small business. That's an outright lie. Big business is using that as an excuse to evade this issue that workers are entitled to a real living wage.
Yeah. All right.
Yay. And now to continue the conversation on the living wage, Leanna Gale.
My name
name is Liana Gale. I'm mainly active in the Green Party, both at the state level and at the local level. And I brought some brochures of the Green Party. I set them over at the table. If you're interested in our values, our four pillars are ecological wisdom, social and economic justice, nonviolence, and grassroots democracy. I will be continuing where Ellen was leaving off. I used to be a scientist, so I'm very interested always in data. So, I mean, my talk here will be very much concentrating on the data I have found out in this discussion on minimum wage and living wage. People who are working full-time should earn enough to be able to make ends meet. This is a basic American value. This is a statement from Leanne Hall, Executive Director of the Alliance for a Just Society, in an article published just at the end of 2013 in The Hill, which is a Washington, D.C. political newspaper. In it, she also mentioned that until now, there has been a lack of data-driven analysis of what it actually takes to make ends meet in the United States today. So there has not been much effort to really calculate how much people need for their livelihood. So the Alliance for a Just Society released such a report where they were calculating on how much it will take to afford the basic necessities of life, and provided analysis on what constitutes a living wage in the publication America's Changing Economy, Searching for Work That Pays in the New Low-Wage Job Market, 2013 Job Gap Study. This study was published in December 2013, so just 2 months ago. In my presentation, I will use quite a bit of data and analysis from that study, from the 2013 Job Gap Study, which in my opinion is the most comprehensive and realistic on the issue of living wages I have come across so far. In regards to calculating a living wage, I have found three measures: a living wage calculator by MIT, then the Family Wage and Budget Calculator from the Jobs Now Coalition. The Family Statewide Research and Policy Coalition are based actually in Minnesota, that promotes jobs that pay a family's supporting wage, and then finally the 2013 Job Gap Study I just mentioned. In the Living Wage Calculator by MIT, developed as part of the Living Wage Project, it includes food, childcare, healthcare, housing, transportation, minimal other necessities, and taxes. There is no money budgeted for clothing, for example, or communication, phone and internet, or savings for emergencies. So how is this a living wage? I mean, yeah. So it's clear that they come up with very low numbers of what it constitutes a living wage. For a single person in Minneapolis, it would just come to at $9.69 per hour at a 40-hour a week job. And that's, they consider that a living wage. $20.64 for a single parent with one child, and $20.11 for two adults, two children household. So both of these, the later examples, would translate into annual wages of more than $40,000. And they're kind of really lowballing in what it really costs to make a living. So the cost of living calculator of the Jobs Now Coalition is a little bit better. It also includes the cost of basic needs for food, housing, healthcare, transportation, and childcare. But in addition, adds household expenditures of clothing, basic telephone service, household furnishing and cleaning, and house maintenance supplies. So this is a bit more realistic. There, the living wage for a single person for the metro area would be $12.08. Again, at a full-time job, for a single parent, $19.35, and four-person household, $18.32. The Alliance for a Just Society analyzed cost of living for 10 states and New York City and did not include Minnesota. On average, though, and excluding New York City, which is a very high-cost place, the living wage for a single adult was calculated to be $16.32 per hour. So they compare that with the $9 the MIT was coming up. $22.75 for a single parent and $30.47 for a family of four with one working parent. The difference in this calculation compared to the others is that transportation costs were assumed to be higher. The costs for household clothing and personal expenses were higher, and a savings rate of 10% for emergencies and savings for retirement was included also. This I would consider a realistic living wage. So I want to kind of switch over to what has been worked on the minimum wage in Minnesota. So the federal minimum wage was enacted through the Fair Labor Standards Act of 1938. The purpose of the act was to eliminate labor conditions detrimental to the maintenance of the minimum standard of living necessary for health, efficiency, and general well-being of workers. So there's this provision in the Fair Labor Standards Act of 1938. Nevertheless, the federal minimum wage has failed to keep up with the rising cost of living and instead keeps working people in poverty. The minimum wage of $7.25 was instated in 2009. In Minnesota, although many workers in Minnesota earn the federal minimum wage of $7.25, the current Minnesota minimum wage is $5.25 for companies that gross less than $625,000 annually and $6.15 for employees at larger companies. If the business is done across state lines, then the federal minimum wage has to be applied. Currently, about 3.9% or 93,000 of Minnesota workers work at or below the federal minimum wage of $7.25. The last increase of the Minnesota minimum wage was in 2005, that is now 9 years ago. There was an attempt to increase it in 2008, but it was voted by our friend Plenty. Minnesota has a distinction of having the second lowest minimum wage in the country after Kentucky. But there are six states that do not have a minimum wage at all. So among the states who have a minimum wage, Minnesota is the second lowest. And one of the reasons for the low minimum wage is that Minnesota's wage does not include a tip credit, which a number of states have. A tip credit allows employers in other states to make up the minimum wage with tips. So, and here, the tipped workers actually get the minimum wage. And I think that might be one of the reasons why the overall minimum wage is so low. So now the platform of the DFL states, we support a minimum wage that keeps pace with inflation and provides full-time workers with an income above the poverty level. Therefore, many expect that the all DFL legislature, which was the first in 20 years to raise the minimum wage last session, but as you all know, it failed to do so. Currently, there are two bills out. On May 3rd, 2013, the House passed a measure, House File 92, to raise the minimum wage to $9.50 at 68 to 62. It also contains an inflation adjustment provision. With Ryan Winkler as the main sponsor, the bill would have raised the minimum wage for large employers making $500,000 or more to $8 an hour August 1st, 2013, $9 per hour in 2014, and $9.50 in 2015. For smaller employers, wages would increase to levels $1 below the level of larger employers. So the final minimum wage would be $8.50 per hour in 2015 for employees working for smaller companies. So this is the bill. I mean, even the $9.50 campaign, nobody is saying that right now in the bill it would only pay $8.50 if you're working for a small employer. An amendment that would have allowed restaurants to pay $7.25 if wage and tips would average above $12 failed to a tie vote. The Senate version, SF3, would have increased minimum wage eventually to $7.75 on August 1st, 2015, but only for large employers. For small employers, the rate would have actually remained at $5.25. Those are kind of the two versions which are out now. Both of them went to conference committee, but the House and Senate were not able to come to an agreement. State Representative Tom Ansel announced in November that he will be introducing his own measure during the 2014 legislative session, calling for $10 an hour and adjusting for inflation, and he wants that to become a constitutional amendment. So if you're kind of getting stuck at $10, that will be it for the minimum wage there. So a large coalition of unions and nonprofit organizations banded together this summer and fall in a campaign to raise the minimum wage from $9.50. If you were at the state fair, you might have noticed the AFL-CIO booth that promoted $9.50. While I can understand some of the reasoning behind this campaign, I do not understand why the unions and other organizations that claim to want to end poverty wages only call for another poverty wage. For example, consider a GRIDO-mobilized petition by Take Action Minnesota, which actually has more than 2,000 signatures. It is entitled Stand with Minnesota Workers to End Poverty Wages, and it's addressed to the Minnesota State Senate. It reads, it's time to put an end to poverty wages by raising our state's minimum wage to at least $9.50 an hour indexed to inflation with no penalty for tips. There's been so much on Facebook, especially coming from Take Action Minnesota and Minnesotans for a Fair Economy, stating that $9.50 is a fair wage, that raising the minimum wage to $9.50 will be an end to poverty wages. sometimes they even slip in the term living wage. I'm not sure why this is being done, but in my mind, to state that $9.50 an hour will end poverty wages is just plain cruel. It also will be difficult to take up the issue of the minimum wage again if the problem of poverty wages is supposedly being solved with a $9.50 minimum wage. So there's quite a momentum behind the $15 an hour campaign. As we have seen from the stopgap study, even $15 an hour is a very conservative number for a minimum wage that is actually a living wage. But there's a movement for $15 an hour growing in Seattle and nationally, spearheaded by fast food workers, a successful ballot initiative in SeaTac, a suburb of Seattle, and by socialist Sharma Savon's successful city council campaign. The new mayor of Seattle, Ed Murray, is also supportive of $15 an hour. A few days ago, a new campaign got started by Sharma Savon, her socialist alternative supporters and union allies. It is called 15now.org, and Ty will tell you all about this a little bit later. And on their website, it states that a $15 minimum wage campaign in Seattle will lay the groundwork for workers, activists, and unions across the country to fight for a living wage. Shall I stop now?
I don't want to get the hook out.
Okay.
I know, and I'm sorry, Liana. We're really constricted for time. But that's a perfect, absolutely perfect segue to the man that almost made it to the city council right here in Minneapolis, Ty Moore.
Thanks so much. Yeah, I think Liani and Alan really laid the groundwork for what I want to focus on in the next few minutes, is talking about what is a strategy that we can win. If not, you know, $15 an hour may be a living wage in some places, but I agree, that's not all we're fighting for. But I think, you know, when we're talking about how do we win victories, we can talk about we want to end poverty, we want all workers to be able to afford, you know, the basic necessity of housing, medical care, food, etc. But we have to recognize that sometimes, you know, steps on the way can be a rallying cry to raise people's confidence, raise people's understanding of what's possible. And I think the campaign for $15 an hour, while by no means being sort of the end goal, is achieving that status across the country. I think it's important to recognize how the minimum wage discussion, the discussion of fighting low wages, is becoming the dominant political theme in U.S. society this year, particularly in the run-up to the 2014 elections. You know, I don't have any illusions that Obama and the leadership of the Democratic Party are really serious about fighting against corporate America, against their corporate sponsors. But it's notable that the most, you know, well-publicized piece of Obama's State of the Union address was his call for a 10-10 minimum wage. Now, there's no intention to actually really fight for that. They say, well, if you want a 10-10 minimum wage, come to the polls in November and get those Republicans out. You know, that's the road to that. There's no real movement-based strategy. And across the country, in over 35 states now, or I think it's around 36 states, there's either legislative battles or ballot initiatives sponsored by the union leaders, for the most part, of the Democratic Party, to raise the minimum wage. Now, most of the time, it's even less than 10-10. It's 8-50, 9-50, et cetera, inadequate. But I think it's an indication that the political leaders of at least one wing of the U.S. ruling class, recognize also that this is a dominant issue. And I think more than anything else, we have Occupy to thank for that, Wisconsin to thank for that, and the struggles of the fast food workers to thank for that, for putting this conversation center stage. And there's a growing number, I think, in the political establishment who recognize, unless we throw a few more crumbs out, unless we offer some measure of change, that there's going to be more Occupy-like events, but probably on a higher scale, on a more substantial scale. And I think that's what's behind the political dialogue that's taking place in D.C. and in states across the country. But for activists, for people who understand the need to fight in a more systematic way for our interests, who understand that this system is rigged against us and the only way we're ever going to win gains is by organizing in our communities and our workplaces to fight back. For us, I think it's also important to recognize the political moment, that we can enter into this discussion that right now is still dominated by the political tops, and retake the initiative. And that's what's happening, I think, in Seattle. It's very, very exciting right now. Michael mentioned, yeah, I ran for city council as a socialist alternative candidate endorsed by the Green Party, SEIU, and a number of other forces. Many people in this room were active and helpful in the campaign. I thank everybody for that. It was painful to come just that short of only 229 votes short. But in Seattle, socialist alternative candidate Shama Sawant won, and actually a much bigger win than even I would have won here. She won on a citywide race, 93,000 votes for an openly socialist candidate. And her main platform sort of slogan was, make Seattle affordable for all. And underneath that she said, we want a $15 an hour minimum wage, we want to tax the rich and big business to fund education, transit, and other social services, and we want affordable housing for all, rent control, moratorium on foreclosures, etc. You know, those were the three highlights. She obviously had a much wider program than that. But I think, you know, that spoke to the anger, not just in Seattle, but across the country, of this growing inequality, that wages are not catching up with the rising cost of living. In particular, Seattle has the fastest growing rent increases in the country, but Minneapolis is not far behind. Rent is a sort of a strange side effect of the foreclosure crisis, that rent prices are quickly going up because of the lack of affordable apartments. So in Seattle, against all odds, we weren't even expecting a victory. Her campaign gained a tremendous momentum, and in particular, the $15 an hour question really caught hold and began to sort of become a major discussion in Seattle politics, to the degree that even before the election, both the leading mayoral candidates and many and several of the city council candidates who were also in competitive races felt compelled themselves to say, yes, of course, I think $15 an hour, that sounds about right. I'm in favor of that. The union leaders who opposed, for the most part, our opponent, Richard Conlon, the 16-year incumbent sort of poster boy for greenwashing corporate politics. Most of the unions endorsed him, but they also endorsed our call for a $15 an hour minimum wage. Now, what they meant by that, the exceptions, etc., I'll get into in a little bit. They are not consistent advocates of this demand. But it showed the political momentum that our campaign developed. And she came to power, or she was won the election in November, and really stole the political show in Seattle. At the inauguration for the new mayor and city council on January 6th, these are normally very staid, formal affairs, people in suits and ties, the families, the politicians, the political elites get together and they clap for their, you know, very relatively staid speeches. We transformed that event utterly and turned it into the largest inauguration Seattle ever seen, and basically into a rally for $15 an hour minimum wage. Normally the corporate mainstream national corporate media doesn't pay attention to little inauguration ceremony in Seattle, but the New York Times, the LA Times, major national TV, international television, and newspapers were all there, mainly to cover Shama Sawant and this new socialist, first socialist elected to a major city council across the country in a long, long time. And she initiated at that inauguration event, she called for the founding of this 15 Now. And a week later, over 500 people packed the labor hall in Seattle to launch 15 Now as a major initiative. 15 Now has gained a lot of momentum and is now the dominant political discussion in Seattle. The mayor has set up a committee, a living wage committee, where he's invited all the main CEOs in town, all the labor leaders, Shama Sawant's on the committee, and he's going to come out with his set of proposals. Now, he says he supports the idea of 15. He's tried to back away from that at different times, saying, well, what's in a number? You know, we have to look at the data, you know, et cetera. But he keeps being forced to come back, yes, 15, but, you know, maybe in 3 years, maybe in 5 years, you know, what exceptions, et cetera. Meanwhile, so we're saying this mayor, under our pressure, he said he will put the mayor will put his committee's recommendations out. And I want to get into the tactics of the campaign in Seattle just to show the dynamics on how we do that, how we operate, and what a movement-based strategy looks like. They're going to come out in mid-April with their recommendations. And basically, their calculation is, the mayor and big business in Seattle is, how many crumbs can we throw to make this movement, to sort of, you know, make the movement appear like they've won a victory and yet appease big business to the most possible. So they have to use the number 15. They're not going to be able to get around that. But maybe they can put it off a few years. Maybe they can put as many exceptions to as many sections of business as possible. Maybe they can do various other things that will minimize the impact on big business profits in Seattle. But the key calculation is, can they take the labor leaders with them? Because our alternative, our threat, is that if they don't come out with something good enough, we're going to bring it to the voters, to the ballot in November. We're already preparing the ground to do that. But we recognize that'll be a colossal campaign. Socialist alternative and sort of the activists alone are not going to be able to do that. Big business will pour in tens of millions of dollars. And SeaTac, a town of 12,000 people, they poured in nearly $2 million to defeat that ballot initiative. And they were successful. The polling numbers just a month before were like 65% support, and it barely scratched by with a couple hundred votes margin because of big business's propaganda campaign against it. They're going to do the same thing in Seattle, but on a much more colossal scale, because they recognize a win for $15 an hour, especially led by a socialist grassroots campaign, will set a very bad precedent for this country. And so they really want to block that. And so we recognize we're not in favor of just sort of, going for it, even if we know we're going to be smashed into defeat. We want to go to the ballot with a strategy to win, but that means we need to have a campaign that can bring, that can compel the labor leaders and the other mass progressive organizations like the NAACP and others to come with us. Right now, they're all endorsing 15 now, but there's a lot of behind-the-scenes discussion about what exactly it is. And we're now in a camp today in Seattle. There's a big organizing meeting to begin building neighborhood assemblies to develop this campaign, campus assemblies, neighborhood meetings, et cetera, to anticipate. We're saying it may not be evident yet, but big business is going to come out hitting hard. And when they come, they're going to come hitting hard. And we have to prepare a counteroffensive on a community grassroots level. And we're saying no waiting. The slogan we have is, the rent won't wait, so why should we? And no exemptions. We may end up being forced into some level of compromise on that question, but we put our position forward from the beginning. We think every worker needs a minimum of $15, and really that's just a starting point. So this campaign, I think, has the potential to really grow and develop and build nationally. We're planning in Seattle a mass meeting at the end of April, and you're all invited. It's a meeting that's designed for two purposes. One, to be a mass discussion after the mayor comes out with his proposal of, should we bring it to the ballot? We have a target of getting 1,000 people from the Seattle area to that meeting to democratically discuss from below, not behind the scenes negotiation. Do we accept the mayor's proposal? Is this enough, or are we going to bring it to the ballot? But it's also a national meeting to try and launch 15 Now nationally. So I only have 2 minutes. I should have timed myself because I lost track of time. But we're going to begin this campaign in Minneapolis on March 15th. We're going to have a March for 15 on March 15th. The time and place isn't quite set yet, but look at Facebook in the next few days. We should have that out there. But we want to get at least 100 people to a founding meeting here in Minneapolis to push on city council, but not just city council, on at the universities, at workplaces, at the airport, etc. I think there's a lot of places. Minnesota has more complicated laws. The word is, though it's not clear and explicit, that it's illegal for cities to raise the minimum wage independent of the state. We want to look into that. We're not confident that's actually accurate. It's not explicit anywhere, but that's the legal framework that is sort of the common wisdom. But we think there's a lot that can be done through massive expansion of living wage ordinances and other tools that the city and other powers have at their disposal. I want to end just with a quick anecdote. This is the 80th anniversary of the 1934 Teamsters strike that I'm sure many people in this room are aware of. But what was so significant about that strike in 1934 was that it won. There'd been lots of strikes before that, very militant strikes. Workers had died on the picket line. But in most cases, because of the misleadership and the lack of vision of the craft union conservative leaders who were not prepared to really break the law, who were not prepared to have a real class struggle approach, most of the strikes up to that point had lost. In 34, because it was led by socialists, and it wasn't just here, there was another major strike of longshore workers in San Francisco and auto workers in Toledo, all of them led by different wings of the socialist movement. They won massive victories. They virtually doubled the wages of truck drivers here in Minneapolis. And that sent a shockwave through the labor movement. So workers everywhere looked up and said, what did they do different in Minneapolis and in San Francisco and Toledo? And they looked and they said, well, one, it was led by socialists. Two, they didn't back down with the National Guard. They didn't come to, anyway, there's a lot of lessons there. But the point is, I think we are potentially in a similar kind of moment in Seattle. Minimum wage is going to be the dominant issue across the country this year. And in Seattle, I think we're set to win the highest minimum wage in the country. And I think people across this country will look, what did they do? What was different in Seattle? What happened there? And I think the lesson that we want to draw out is that it was a class struggle approach. It was a movement-based approach. There weren't behind-the-scenes negotiations with politicians. It was clearly run in opposition to the two corporate parties as an independent campaign, and it was led by radicals. It was led by people who don't think the capitalist system will deliver on its own and who understand the need that the only way we're going to win gains is by building a movement that challenges the logic of this rotten system, that challenges a two-party system, and is prepared to go all the way in the fight for workers' rights. I think if we can spread that lesson from Seattle to Minneapolis and across the country, I think we may be in for a real new period in U.S. society where it won't just be a fight on low wages, but a generalized fight against the inequalities, the racism, the sexism, and all the problems that this corporate-driven political system has tried to make working people pay for. I think it's time for us to stand up, and I think we're on the cusp of a new phase in U.S. society. So, thanks.
Wow. Okay, guys, so we're going to do a little bit of a public discussion at this point. Church, could you actually help me just kind of guide the public discussion here? Because I'm going to be doing this for the doctors.
Okay.
So this is it, folks. What do you guys got to say about what's been said so far?
Find the next speaker.
Okay. Hi, everybody. I really like what was said, and I like what you said, that the rent won't wait, so we won't wait. It reminds me of what Mayor Dale Lucero once said, hard times ain't quit, and we ain't quit. I like that. And who would like to go next? Doug, are you next?
I think he was.
Would you like to go next?
I really like the passion in that last presentation because you realize if you're getting paid with fraudulent currency, the value of the currency is completely malleable by the owners of the Federal Reserve. It's not even a government thing. You go to $15 an hour, the value goes down, you're still making less than 10, 7 bucks an hour. It's the same game. You can't keep going to the same illegitimate government and beg for your basic rights and expect to get them. At some point, you're going to have to turn away, create a new society and a new government on a global scale. I wrote a book explaining how that would look. It's on Amazon.com. It's of, by, and for the people by Angelo Patrick Gardeman, and I'll email it free to anybody who wants it. They write their email address on this piece of paper. It's a serious, structured solution, a real political solution, a complete break from the flawed social constructs that we have today.
What's the author's name?
Angelo Patrick Gardeman. If you give me your email address, I'll mail you the PDF.
Here's the book.
There's the book. There's an audio book, too.
Hey, my name is Doug Mann. I'm running for the Minneapolis School Board. I've done this before. One of the things that I have on my platform is fight for a $15 per hour minimum wage. Help us put an amendment to the Minneapolis City Charter on the ballot that raises the minimum wage to $15 an hour, effective immediately, and annual cost of living increases. When I was doing legal research on the stadium lawsuits, I came across some case law that said, among other things, that cities with home rule charters could exercise the full powers of the state, to benefit local residents. One of the things that we're looking at in terms of doing a ballot initiative here in Minneapolis is, if we can make, we can anticipate that there'll be legal challenges because this has never been done before. But I think we have a legal basis for it. Under the leadership of the Democratic Party, of course, there's never been an effort to do this. But I think that So I'm going to be doing some research on this issue, and we're going to try to draw in some lawyers who people will believe before they'll believe me, anyway. But anyway, thanks.
Involved,
yeah,
or no?
There you go. Technology, right? Yeah, thank you all for coming. I just wanted to make a comment that applies generally to the evening or the afternoon talk. If you go back to the Sun Tzu and the Art of War, there's a lot of useful information in terms of adversarial conflicts. It says that supreme excellence consists in victory without fighting, which I think is important. It also has a lot to say about how you should try to apply, look for natural tension in a situation and try to snap the tension so it's like a boulder rolling downhill. And I think those are important organizing principles to look at. And so in the more modern era, a lot of this kind of thinking was reparsed into a kind of field of analysis called fourth generation warfare, which I think can be applied to networked conflict, independent and horizontal organizing that doesn't require top-down organizations to kind of direct people like cadres. And so one thing to understand about fourth generation warfare, you can go home and look this up, sort of Google around, and the acronym for it is 4GW. So the idea is called Observe, Orient, Decide, Act, Decision Loop Theory. And so the idea is that, like, if your adversary has a slower method of executing and then, or determining and then executing decisions, and then you have a faster method of determining and then executing actions, then you gain the initiative, and then you have a much higher likelihood of defeating them in whatever your objective is. So, if you can confuse their stage of observing or orienting or deciding or acting at each stage of that, you have a more of an advantage tactically. And so, if you have like a network of people that are communicating over Twitter and stuff like that, you can get involved in issues. I do advocate for people to go down and lurk at the legislature and try to figure out what's going on with bills. If you jump in at the right time, you can actually disrupt the adversarial decision cycles from being executed correctly if you know where and when to be, and you can get that information out to other people. Then you can act horizontally without being inside the same top-down organization. So anyway, just want to mention, it's OODA. Observe, Orient, Decide, Act, Decision Loop Theory, Fourth generation warfare, partially derived from older wisdom like the Sun Tzu. That's the thing that applies very broadly to a whole panoply of different issues. So thank you very much.
All right. Ben, get up. It's very short, Mike Lee.
Why doesn't everybody want to speak? Find out.
I just want to say that's a version of the old adage that a lie gets halfway around the world before truth gets its boots on. And, you know, this is an old human struggle. And these are like a buddy group of billionaires that they're sitting on like $2 trillion just in America alone. They could just use their vast networks of whatever. And some sociologists should come up with how long it takes to educate the populace, whatever populace is involved, like a metro area or whatever, and they should have to allow for that time period instead of all this speed-up stuff. You know, if you're in your union, you hear about one of the abuses is they put speed-ups on the workers, and we just can't have this speedy pace of making decisions because it's just feeding into that lie, or that lie that gets happening around the world.
Anybody else?
Okay,
all right. Okay, is there a doctor in the house? Is there a couple of doctors in the house? Will the doctors please come over and confirm the nurse's diagnosis? Come on up, guys. So, I'm very honored here to present Dr. David Mayard and Dr. Laura Lehman. And they're going to be speaking on the Affordable Care Act and beyond, single payer now.
Yes.
By the way, can we give a quick shout out for Dan Fite? By the way, he's the tech guy that made this whole technical thing happen. And is the guy that's responsible for the live stream, which is going on all over the nation right now as we speak. Okay, doctor.
All right. So. I'm Dave Merritt, I'm a psychiatrist. I do home visits for people with severe and persistent mental illness for my regular job. Let's go to the next slide. I've also been with the single parent movement for probably about 8 or 9 years now, first down in Iowa, now up here in Minnesota. But I'm also besides wanting a single parent for patients, I'm also a father and husband, and I also want to make sure that these people in this picture have the health care they need when they need it as well. On the next slide. So quick, some definitions. There's a lot of talk about health insurance and health care, and oftentimes politicians will use those terms as though they mean the same thing. I think that's very confusing to people. Health insurance is simply a means to pay for health care, and at some point should, in my opinion, anybody who pays for it, a third party, be making medical decisions. I believe that decision between a patient and their provider. But there's different types of health insurance right now that exist in the U.S. There's public insurance, such as Medicare, Medicaid, and the VA system. And then there's private insurance, such as through the private insurers, Blue Cross, Blue Shield, United Health Partners. Now, unfortunately, also, the private companies try to work their way into Medicaid and Medicare. That's where Medicare Part D is, unfortunately. It creates a lot of extra waste. So we don't have a clean public system, unfortunately, by and large, but the best is example is probably the VA, which actually has amazing return on investment for healthcare. Also, such a huge respect, Dr. Layman is also here. Could she has some handout? And also, if there's any healthcare providers in the room as well, we'd love to have you join the Physicians for National Health Program. Health Program in Minnesota. We have a sign-up sheet for that if anybody's interested. Moving on to healthcare, which is really what is most important to me, is how we deliver care to the people that need it. So there's public providers of healthcare, such as through the VA system, the county hospitals, HCMC would be an example. And then there's private healthcare delivery as well. I worked for a private practice for one job, and I work in a nonprofit mental health service agency for my other job, both private institutions, but most care is delivered privately in the U.S. right now. And even most people are providers for kids or Medicare, maybe a public payment system, are still private providers. Next slide, please. So universal coverage is something that we're really striving for, and that term has been thrown around describing the Obamacare, which is really not accurate, because the goals of healthcare reform, in my opinion, should have been covering three areas, namely provide coverage and access to healthcare for the people that need it. That's number one. It needs to cover everybody, not just for people who have the financial means to do so. Number two, it needs to control the costs, and the costs are the real problem here, and I'll get to that momentarily. So, getting care to the people that need it, reducing costs, and improving quality is another aspect of it. And some measures in Obamacare to try to get at the issue of improving quality, I don't think most of those are going to work very well, but they're at least trying something there. And pretty much every other industrialized country has some form of universal coverage, but we do not here in the U.S. Socialized medicine is a type of universal coverage. It's done in, for example, Great Britain, New Zealand, where the government owns the hospitals and also pays for the services. And within the U.S., this is sort of like the VA system. And lastly, single payer, which is seen in countries such as Canada, Taiwan, and Australia, where one payer just pays all the medical bills. Or government agency, either federal or in Canada, provincial, pays the providers to deliver care. Most of the providers are still private providers. Next slide, please. So here's healthcare spending per person in the United States and I believe seven other industrialized countries. This data is a little bit old, so I can guarantee it's worse since then. And bear in mind, the other countries provide coverage for all of their citizens. So even though we don't provide care for everybody, we're still spending more than twice what everybody else is spending right now for healthcare. Next slide, please. Why is this that our system costs so much, and yet I don't have time to go through all of this, but our outcomes are not that great either. We're ranked 34 by the World Organization as far as quality of healthcare, so we're certainly not exemplary, despite what some people may say to the contrary. The reason for this is because we have a lot of administrative waste in our system. For every dollar that's spent on healthcare in the U.S., 31 cents of that goes towards administrative costs. Next slide, please. Here's a simplified diagram showing our healthcare system. All right, bear with me. The red lines are taxes. So these are patients. These are all of us. This is everybody in the U.S. We pay taxes that go to the federal government. We pay taxes that go to the state of Minnesota. We pay a Medicare tax as well. Employers also pay a tax to the state, to the federal government, and they also pay a tax that goes towards Medicare, but basically that's the money flow through taxes. Out-of-pocket spending. Patients, we all generally, I'm sure you're all aware, you have co-pays, deductibles that you have to pay directly to your provider, as represented here by Dr. Green. Also, patients through the PA system often have small co-pays as well. Next line is the flow of money. So, some of us have health savings accounts, which I think is, well, I won't go into that too much, but the point is, money goes into here, comes back here to pay, employers put money into the health savings accounts. That doesn't happen so much anymore. More and more of us are going to be having these because the trend through Obamacare is more and more high deductible health plans. Anyway, so we also pay, we can buy health insurance. Actually, this is pre-Obamacare, just to be clear, this is pre-Obamacare. We pay for health insurance. A lot of times our employers will also pay part of our premium for health insurance. The federal government will pay for health insurance for their employers, for their employees. The federal and state governments will provide Medicaid coverage for their citizens. Often it's contracted through the third parties, the private payers. Medicare, unfortunately, also has private Medicare Part B, and there's also supplemental Medicare Advantage plans. They may or may not pay providers for delivering healthcare services. Same with Medicaid, same with Medicare. And finally, healthcare delivery is the brown. The VA and the doctors provide healthcare here. This is the only place in the diagram where there's actually any delivery of healthcare. All right, next slide, please. So, part of that 31% of administrative overhead, 12 to 20% is insurance overhead. Next slide. So what is that? So the insurance companies spend a great deal of money on marketing. You've seen the billboards around, you've seen the ads, you've seen the commercials. Underwriting, this is deciding who's a high risk for them to take because they may, God forbid, be ill. We don't want to insure them. Next slide. There's been a lot of money here lobbying both the federal government and the state governments. Next slide, please. That the assemble networks, this is negotiating prices with the providers and seeing how low they can go as far as paying the people who actually deliver healthcare. Next slide, please. Denying payment to providers. I spent a lot of my time dealing with this particular issue or people in my office. I spent a lot of time doing that as well. Next slide. Denying treatment to patients. Doctors, sometimes they don't get paid, so they say, I'm sorry, I can't provide you that service. Next slide. Executive salaries. Next slide. Profit for the insurance companies. In Minnesota, fortunately, they're a nonprofit, but they still got plenty of money in the bank. Moving on.
Next
time. Yep. There's also, on the other side, this is something that often gets left out when people talk about this in the political spectrum, and there's a lot of costs that aren't incurred on the provider side. They often say, the insurance over there is only 15%. But that's not really accurate because on the provider side, we spend a lot of time and money to get that payment finally delivered to us. Next slide. What is that overhead? We have to pay office staff that have to, negotiate with the billing departments, with the insurance companies to get them to pay. Next slide, collect all the insurance information. We have to get prioritizations in time before we pay the medications or procedures paid for. Next slide. We have to try to determine what medications they have. I spend a lot of time doing this sort of junk where I was like, I don't care what tier, I'm just going to get what they need. I don't want to think about that sort of thing. Next slide. All right, there's also employer overhead. So this is the employers also have to spend a lot of time and money trying to get insurance for their employees if they're so inclined. So next slide. They have to bid, they have to open enroll, they have to sign up all their patients every year. I'm not sure why these are on a yearly basis. It's not like people are necessarily going to change every year, but that's the way we got it right now. They have to bid, they have to negotiate with the insurance companies to find out who can give them the best price, I guess. Next slide. They also have to pay the premiums, there's a lot of paperwork and logistical aspects of that as well. Next slide. work with some sort of bank or company to put money into the health savings account. Next slide. Also, patient overhead is not included in 31%, but I think all of you are familiar with this thing. Next slide. Spend a lot of time and money paying our premiums. Next slide. Paying our bills to the providers. Next slide. Getting those bills in the mail. Making withdrawals from accounts. A lot of paperwork, faxes, emails, phone calls. Next slide. Get these things in the mail for the accreditation benefits. You look at it like, I don't know what this thing means. I don't know what to do with this thing. Like, just keep it for a while, then you recycle it because you don't know what to do with it. Next slide. All right, so Obamacare fortunately fixes all that by adding another layer of by adding the health insurance exchange. There's some new rules in here to make it to keep these guys in line a little bit. There's also rules to keep us in line, so that everybody has to buy insurance. That they have to provide at least some sort of basic minimum of services that causes the prices to go up, unfortunately. But we also have the health insurance exchange, so the patients can spend their money directly. They can get a, they may get some additional help from the federal government. And then the states probably, I probably should put one more earlier going after there. Then that goes to the third party payers. There is no public option. Then they may or may not pay the provider. So as you can see, Obamacare, unfortunately, is not going to address any of the fundamental issues. We will reduce the number of uninsured. There are some good things about the program. I'm not going to pretend that Obamacare is completely terrible. But unfortunately, it doesn't really solve any of the problems. Next slide. What is single payer? This is what single payer would look like if we had it in Minnesota. Eliminate all that junk, all that extraneous garbage, all the third-party payers, all the complexity, and it would reduce the overhead dramatically. Next slide, please. A study was done by the Lumen Group, which, as it is a subsidiary of United Health Group. So their study, if anything, would be biased against single payer. If single payer was to be enacted in Minnesota in 2014, this is current healthcare spending, $46 billion in the state of Minnesota. That's all payments. That's from the government. That's from individuals. That's from businesses. That's totally how much is spent on healthcare within the state. So if we had a single payer system, there'd be increased utilization by people who do not have insurance now. There'd be reduced co-payments because the plans they had no co-payments. Reduced utilization management. So that's what utilization management is all that co-payments. It's all the prioritization, all the stuff that sort of tries to tell people, tell providers what they can do as far as treatment. And then there would be reduction of fraud because they actually have some, the government can actually pursue fraud. People sometimes think that there's no fraud in the private insurance industry. So we hear about the Medicare fraud when it happens, but it goes on just as much in the private market as well. So that would actually reduce spending. So there would be an increase in spending as far as utilization of healthcare services. But by using bulk purchases, being able to negotiate with the drug companies and the medical devices, we can save $877 million in the state of Minnesota. By reducing the administrative overhead on the eliminating the insurance companies, because we won't need them, hospital administration and physician administration costs reduced by $4.7 billion. So the net savings, in the end, reduce healthcare spending within the state, covering everybody for all their healthcare needs, but reduce spending for healthcare in the state by $4 billion. Next slide, please. So the long-term goal, after we pass this in Minnesota in 2015, will be national single payer. And that's even simpler than it should be. There may exist, alongside a separate VA system, also, I didn't think that we heard of Indian Health System, there's a few other kind of side things that may operate in tandem. But the point is, by reducing the complexity, by reducing the things that don't matter, this is what matters right here. That's really the only thing on that slide that matters for most of us. We need to eliminate all extraneous stuff. It doesn't matter. And I think that's my last slide. Any questions?
There are more and more, especially so they're just, the people who need it the most are not being covered. So, you know, that's just something else to think about with the affordable care. And also I would say that in listening to everything you've talked about up to this point, including Dr. Mayer's presentation and listening to the presentations before that, it seems to me that the big problem is the corporatization of government, because, you know, that is not in our best interest. It's in governance is now in the best interest of the corporations. So, any other questions?
Shout out.
What do you mean exactly?
We have this beautiful protest sign in South Carolina.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, and so that was something that doesn't get involved in here anymore. So either the Southern Heights.
Well, I know Dr. Elizabeth Frost was involved with that protest as well. She's with PNHP Minnesota.
Yeah,
I mean, we do. Protest per se. We do meet with legislators and we do a lot of speaking and educating and that sort of thing. Well, yeah, I think so. I mean, we've managed to gain support within every year. We were able to get more legislators to at least put their name on as a supporter for the, there's a single payer bill.
Is that good? Is it a good, is the bill good?
Absolutely, yeah. Senator John Marty is the one behind that. It's very, very good.
Yeah, I
thing I don't think this is something I think business should be behind. I mean, I know it's a huge headache for a lot of businesses to try to insure their employees. I mean, a lot of businesses really do want to do well by their employees. Well, I can't. I mean,
yeah, President Obama $9,000, in Australia it was $16,000, so that would be
more, and then we're going to go to the next speaker.
Hi, thank you for your presentation. I'm a bookkeeper at Ham Clinic. It's an outpatient mental health clinic. And my job is to deal with insurance companies, or what I call the spawn of Satan, is to find out what's the copay, what's the deductible, are we in network, are we out of network, is a prior authorization needed? And it is so time consuming. It's amazing. And it's just, if everybody had MA, it would be so much more simple. And we have people who have insurance, but they have like a $5,000 or $3,000. One person even has a $10,000 deductible. So they have to pay that first before their insurance even kicks in. And I'm in St. Paul, and there's a hospital, it used to be called Ramsey County Medical Center. It got taken over by Health Partners. And they receive money from the federal government to deliver services to the working poor. I think it's called Medicaid. And Health Partners has provided no information on what they've done with that federal, what services have they provided. So they take the money and provide no information. So the corporations are coming into the MA, the Medicaid money, and they're taking that money, but they're not telling you what services.
All right. One last thing to add on to that is that most bankruptcy in the US currently is because of medical expenses, 62%. And of those, 78% had health insurance when they got sick, so it's not like it's just people who don't have health insurance.
Right. Let's give them a round of applause, you guys. And I'm glad that the doctors confirmed the nurse's diagnosis on the healthcare system. I had to say that. Our next speaker, actually two speakers, belongs to what I have always called one of the most ballsiest and most honest organizations in the Twin Cities, Community United Against Police Brutality. And even though he wants to kick my ass right now, I love the man dearly. I'm talking, of course, about Daryl Robinson, and I believe Jan coming up too, right? Is it Daryl and Jan, or just Daryl? Okay, so Daryl Robinson, and you're going to be speaking on the initiative you're working on right now, right? Daryl Robinson.
Hi, I'm Daryl Robinson. I'm the Vice President of Communities United Against Police Brutality. Just to give you guys a little bit of information about ourselves, we are a racial and a social justice organization. And what we do is, we do three things. We advocate for people dealing with the effects of police brutality. And what we do is we, just like if somebody get abused by law enforcement, we'll go to court with them to help them get their charges dismissed. And then once we get them cleared of all their charges and things like that, and then we set them up with an attorney. If they need psychological help, we'll set them up with a psychologist. And we'll actually, we go out and educate the community also, whether it be going to court with people, because a lot of times people get abused by the system. And then it goes from the street police to the judicial process, where the judges will take over and then get them locked up or whatever. So we'll go through the judicial process with them also. And we might go out in the community, do cop watch, or do a Know Your Rights training to go out and empower people of what to say and what to do in those situations. Because it might be like a walking stop where people are just walking down the street where they're approached by the police. And a lot of times in that situation, people don't know what to do or what to say in that situation. So we'll actually teach them Know Your Rights training to tell them exactly what to do and exactly what to say in those situations. It might be a traffic stop, which most people or actually get in this particular situation because a walking stop, you don't need an ID to walk down the street. And the police shouldn't ask you for an ID for you walking down the street. But if you're driving, that's a privilege. So you have to have a driver's license to drive. So if you get stopped in that situation, a lot of times police are trained to actually arrest and prosecute you. So they're going to criminalize you in that situation. So we teach people what to do and what to say in that situation. And then there's a home stop when they come up to your house and knock on your door. And they'll criminalize you in that situation. So we teach people what to say and what to do in that situation also. So Communities United Against Police Brutality, we're trying to bring police brutality to a stop, where we're trying to completely stop it. So that's what we do in those situations. But right now, what we're working on is, and this is for the Minneapolis voter. What we're doing is, we're working on a charter amendment. A charter amendment is your city laws. And we're working on a charter amendment to get police, okay, I see the gentleman right up here. We're working on a charter amendment to bring Minneapolis to voters, and we need 14,000 votes for this in the next election cycle. And just like you have malpractice insurance for doctors and nurses, we're trying to do the same thing for policemen right now. And right now we're up to $20 million in the last 7 years, and we're paying that, me and you as taxpayers. Every time police get a police brutality claim, we're paying that out of our pocket. And so there's no accountability for police, so they're just going to the surplus fund and they're getting that all out of that. So Communities United Against Police Brutality, we're trying to have it so they would have to pay their own police brutality insurance, whether it's the city paying it or they'll pay to a certain amount, and then a road police, and then they'll have to pay to a certain amount. But what'll wind up happening is an insurance company will step in, and they'll pay so much money, and the insurance company will look at them and say, well, we keep having problem with this particular officer. So that particular officer, the insurance will kick in. You'll have to pay so much. Then the insurance company will say, you know, we're having problems with you. So what we're going to do is we're going to take your peace officer license. Then that police officer will lose his job. So we're currently working on that. Jan got some information here for some Minneapolis voters. But we're currently working on that. And then, and this will actually, not only will this help out the voters and the citizens of Minneapolis, but this will also help out good police officers, because good police officers go out and do good policing. So the bad police are the ones that keep making the problems worse, because they keep going out and doing the same thing. And these people that we call thumpers. So the thumpers that keep going out, and then they're the one that's getting promoted. They're the one that's going out and getting the sergeant and the lieutenant jobs. So this would actually make the good police be good police, and then they can go out and then they can whistleblow and tell what's going on, and then they won't get in trouble for it. So this is what Communities United Against Police Brutality is working on for police brutality insurance. So if you guys haven't heard about it, you know, you can come up to us and we'll talk to you about what we're doing. But we're trying to get this on the election cycle. So again, I'm Darryl Robinson. Thank you guys for having us here.
Thank you.
You guys, just so you know, this campaign, I am so excited about it. One thing that Daryl didn't mention, that this campaign is making history. It's doing two things. It's something that will actually really effectively hold the police accountable. And more importantly, it takes the decision of the thumper cops out of those in City Hall who protect the thumper cops and puts it right into the hands of us, we the people of Minneapolis. And it's making history. It's never been tried anywhere else. And to show you just how effective this campaign is, anybody who's involved in the civil rights campaign will know this. When you start getting effective, they start changing laws. They did that in Minneapolis. They changed the charter. When we got this going, we had only gathered about, I believe, 4,000 or 5,000 signatures. They changed the charter as we were doing it, which shows me that we are being effective. We're back on the road. We're going to fight these people. Thank you. All right. Now, our next speaker is a young lady that I had just met today. I'd actually seen you on, I checked you out on YouTube. You're great. I loved everything I've seen about you so far, and I apologize about the misspelling of your name. I never did get that fixed. But this young lady is actually currently running for office in the St. Paul area, I believe, going for the Minnesota House.
Yes.
This young lady could actually make history and become the one of the very first Green Party elected officials on the state level in the Minnesota House. And she came here under the very direct and glowing recommendations of Amber Garland here. So please give a big, big thank you and welcome to Lena Buggs.
Sure, glad I didn't have to follow Mark, let me tell you. But I will get to my campaign momentarily. What I really wanted to talk about today, that's really of importance, I think, to everybody that came out in this room, is I want to talk about the emergence of the third party. Right now, the climate in Minnesota is such that, as Ty indicated and a number of speakers indicated, the climate is such that poor and working families aren't being represented at the state legislature. Single-payer health care keeps getting tabled at the state legislature. The movement to legalize marijuana now is going to be brought up at the state legislature. However, with it being mostly a Democratic state, the Democrats are pushing this $9.50 minimum wage, which we know is going to keep people in poverty. It will not bring people in poverty. In fact, $9.50 minimum wage actually keeps people at 25% below the poverty level. And we also know that living wages, even $15 an hour for living wages, aren't enough. So basically what I want to say is we need more third-party candidates, socialist alternatives, and Green Party candidates such as myself, such as Doug Mann, who's running for the school board. But my campaign is very exciting. I'm very excited for this campaign. I'm vying to become the first African-American female Green Party state legislator. I will be working with all social, racial, economic, and environmental justice programs. So I want each and every one of you to know that you have a friend at the state legislature. More importantly, you know a person here who has struggled financially, a person who has experienced poverty, a person who has experienced working for just above minimum wage, which I call adult living wage, which is $10 per hour. So I think it's important that we start supporting grassroots activists such as myself who are now throwing their hats into the political arena. It was a travesty that Ty Moore lost by 229 votes. We should have all been supporting Ty Moore. We should have all been supporting Doug Mann in his bid for the mayoral campaign here. And I'm asking for your support today because my campaign is going to be multicultural, multi-issue. It's going to transcend race. It's going to transcend age and gender. I want everybody involved in my campaign because we really have the opportunity to do something great. We really have the opportunity to push single-payer health care. And I will make this possible because I've established relationships with the state legislature. Many of you may recall when I got almost kicked out of the state legislature, when I confronted our governor, Governor Dayton, over giving $975 million for corporate welfare to Ziggy Wilf, and I stood up against that. And the group that I was with, the Welfare Rights Organization, stood up against that to fight as well, too. But it's also important, too, that we talk about the disparities in our school systems as well. There's a growing disparity between children of color and white citizens. Urban school districts are disproportionately disadvantaged. We have a culture problem in our school systems, primarily with the one-size-fits-all curriculum. Well, we know that children don't always learn the same way. We know that we need to expand our curriculums. I'm going to be working with Superintendent Silva on developing and coming up with a curriculum that's beneficial for children of color and children, period. I think that class sizes need to be reduced, and right now the St. Paul Teachers Union is going to be authorizing a vote for a strike on February 24th. I just want to go on record as saying I support the teachers. I think that the union should be recognized, class sizes should be reduced, and I also think that paraprofessionals need to be paid a fair and a living wage. So I just wanted to thank you all for coming today. I know that we're progressive here, but I'm the progressive candidate that you actually want to vote for. I want to see each and every one of you work on my campaign, because together we can bring Minnesota back to be the envy of the United States. People used to move here to Minnesota because why? We had good schools. We had great health care. We had opportunity. Well, that's diminished now. For the first time during this last legislative session, we had a Democratic governor, we had a Democratic Senate, and we had a Democratic House of Representatives. And what did they do? What did Governor Dayton do? He ran under the moniker of tax the rich and help the poor. Well, he didn't do that, and not only did he do that, he cut $350 million in health and human services. He gave corporate welfare to Ziggy Wilf, and now he's enacting this bonding bill for $1 billion. Who thought it was a good idea to vote this guy into office knowing he's a millionaire? How is he going to serve the interests of poor and working families and families in general here? He isn't. So the Democratic Party isn't working. We know the Republican Party isn't working. And now is the time for a Green Party candidate such as myself and a socialist alternative candidate to come up and really, really represent the needs of the people. And this is a winnable race, and I need all of your help and all of your support. I want to thank you. Yes, you had a question.
Do you have a website yet?
Or yes, my website is lenafor65a.com. It's L-E-N-A. FOR65A.com. And some of the legislation that I plan to introduce should I be elected, I plan to introduce a bill to legalize marijuana for medicinal purposes for agricultural farming. I also plan to legalize marijuana also for recreational purposes too. I think that the criminal justice system has made enough money of incarcerating people, so I plan to do that. In St. Paul and Minneapolis too, I'm born and raised in Minneapolis, moved to St. Paul in 2008, but I have a lot of friends here, but we have a housing crisis in St. Paul, and I know we do here in Minneapolis as well, but 60% of the residents in my district are renters, and what I plan to do is I plan to introduce legislation that if landlords freeze the rents for a period of 2 years or more, they get a tax break. So I plan on doing that as well, too, to stabilize the rents. I also plan on bringing back the contract for deed loan programs to the loan administrators as well, too, because contract for deed, basically, it's between the seller and the buyer. We need those programs because those programs will help people of color and disadvantaged people and people in general who can't afford to get a FHA or VH loan. So we need to reinstitute those programs. There needs to be subsidies. You know, government does have a role to play here with the citizens. They take our taxes. They should provide us with services. It's just real easy. It's simple as that, folks. So I wanted to thank everybody for coming today, and please join the Lena Bugs campaign. Yes? Well, that's part of what I'm going to be bringing forth. Right now, it isn't sure. They're going to be taking that up this legislative session. So they're going to be taking that up. Now, last year, single-payer health care, that got tabled. It went into conference committee. It got tabled. I will be bringing that up again until they get the damn point.
If I wanted to make a contribution to your campaign, who would I make the check out to?
You would make it to the committee to elect Lena Bugs for 65A.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, everybody.
We
got more questions.
When you're talking about legalization, are you talking about medical only or like for everybody?
No,
I'm talking across the board. We're talking for medicinal purposes, for agricultural farming, and for recreation. So across the board. Yes, sir.
I'm just curious, who you, I may have missed this, but who are you running against?
Well, I'm not running against anyone. I'm running for my district. However, the incumbent's, yes, the incumbent's name is Rena Moran. And just to give you a little bit of background, she ran under some of the same things that I'm saying, but because she's a Democrat, she hasn't lived up to those. And people are upset in the district. You know, the Welfare Rights Committee went to her and asked, hey, we have a plan to get 70,000 Minnesota children out of poverty. And you know what she said? I don't want to be the token African-American. I'll sign on to your bill, but I won't author it. So what we need is we need more third-party candidates. You know, the Green Party, I won't take any corporate donations. It's strictly going to be, you know, hand-to-mouth from the likes of you good people who show up and who believe in grassroots democracy, who believe in social and economic justice, who believe in taking care of the environment, who believe that we should have a choice in terms of what we put into our bodies, and who believe that there should be some legislation around genetically modified organisms or GMO. So that's what I'm standing for. Yes, ma'am.
And I was told by the good Democrats that if they had surplus, if they could afford it, they would do this. They would end the disparity. In other words, if you're going to adopt a child, you get exactly half of what a foster care parent gets. Now, that's just insane.
It is.
In fact, I think adoptive parents, whether it's a single person or a couple, should be given more money. It takes more money to raise a child for a lifetime. It's a collective social responsibility. And I plan to run for office for mayor in the city that I live in. And I will be running on that. I won't sign up with any organization, Green, or any other organization, unless they will absolutely assure me that they stand for ending the disparity in foster care, not by lowering the foster care payments, but raising the adoption subsidy, and that breast milk is a birthright to all children.
And I agree with you, and I would be willing to actually come up with some legislation around that. I'd like to help you on your campaign. These campaigns aren't easy, but I just want to say that the great Democrats, you know, they promised that there would be change, and they simply haven't done that. The Republicans, of course, don't want to do that because they're for the corporations. Now, we also have to support low-wage workers' rights to unionize, right? I mean, it's ridiculous that McDonald's has an 800 number so that their employees can call and get subsidies, can get welfare. That's ridiculous when they're making billions in profits. So we've got to get back to this people over profit mentality. And the corporations cannot be trusted to do that on their own. That's why there has to be legislation around that. You know, to do business in the great state of Minnesota, it's a privilege, it's not a right, just because you're a corporation, that's ridiculous. So I'm gonna be bringing forth legislation that says, you know what, in order to do business in our state, you have to not only hire people from the state of Minnesota and pay them a fair and living wage of at least $15 an hour, because you're not gonna have the right to limitations on liability, and you're not gonna pay people fair wages. So, yes ma'am. No, we are not.
Not at all?
No.
Not even as a candidate?
No.
Okay, because Holly Bryan and I have discussed that, so you may want to talk to her about that. And when does your petitioning start, and how many signatures do you need?
Well, actually, you only need signatures if you can't afford to pay the filing fee. So I'm gonna be paying the filing fee myself.
That's true.
Alan?
Yeah, one thing that I think that needs to be talked about is at-will employment, because that's the major obstacle to union organizing in the state. Plus, it allows employers to engage in racist hiring practices and racist firing practices, and we need to go to a just type of system rather than at-will employment. I don't know what your thoughts are on that.
No, I agree with you, and as I said, you know, I don't have the answers to all of our problems that we have. That's why I depend on working with people, and I want to bring forth the bills and be held accountable by the people. So it's important that you grab a hold of me and say, well, listen, you know, these are the bills that should be brought forth in the state legislature. Because I'm going to tell you, there's a handful of support for these bills, but they're never going to get pushed through unless you have politicians, or rather activists who become politicians, which is exactly what I am. You know, so there's about four or five of us now. But, you know, this at-will employment, it keeps people stagnant. You're in fear because you're going to lose your job. It's lorded over your head, so to speak. So, yes, there does need to be some legislation around that as well, too. And I just want to make sure that everyone knows that I will work with every activist group in this room and beyond this room to make sure that we restore Minnesota back to its prominence. Yes. It hasn't been proven to cause cancer. Marijuana isn't tobacco. And you know what? You do have the right to object. The reason that I'm pushing the legislation is because I'm taking the criminalization of marijuana out of that for that very purpose. Yes.
You know, we have the right to choose to drink alcohol. It creates an unbelievable hazard on the road, right? So the right to be able to choose whether you want to smoke marijuana. You know, my son is flying out to California in 2 weeks, and he's driving a friend of his to prison for the next, I think he's in prison for the next 3 years. We're growing marijuana legally, according to the state, but then the federal government came in, raided them, and his friend is taking him to jail
For a nonviolent crime.
Yeah,
that's ridiculous.
He's a political person.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. One thing that Democrats have embraced the corporate school reform that's clearly, you know, from Obama on down. Mm-hmm. And one thing they ignore is racial disparities and exposure of students to inexperienced teachers and watered down curriculum. This is an issue I've been raising as a school board candidate for years. And that subject is taboo in the Democratic Party. No candidate running seeking DFL endorsement will touch that. The corporate school reforms, which involve taking away teacher tenure rights and seniority rights, and this watered down curriculum that they call the Common Core, and teaching to the test and paying teachers according to student test results. You know, that whole program is ruining education, and it's not dealing with the inequities that are causing differences in achievement. It's educational malpractice, actually.
Well, you know, corporations, they're not satisfied with poking their nose into labor and wage issues, so now they're going after the school systems right now. And you're right, the Democrats and the Republicans haven't tackled that. They're not tackling these social economic issues, but this campaign will.
You guys, I got a very quick question for you. We got four more people to speak. I'm fine with this continuing on. Do we want to take a quick break?
Yes.
Please do.
Just on the marijuana issue, there's been a lot of repression around that, and I'm going to bring up the term hemp. It's very important that we understand what hemp is. And for those of you who don't know hemp, hemp is an element, a derivative that you can derive from marijuana. Remember, marijuana is not marijuana. It's just a plant. It's a plant. Yes, it's a plant. And we decriminalize the plant. And hemp, if you study hemp and do your research, hemp can power our world. We could, cotton from the fibers that we get from hemp, we can power our cars, we can manufacture our clothes, we can create an economy and industries around hemp. There's been a lot of repression, and there's been a lot of people that have lost their lives, that have been thrown away, whether in prison or just by other forms of oppression. And so I think what you're stating, because you said the agricultural purposes, which I totally agree with, and we have, this is why we have to objectively look at the pros and cons of each issue and go deep into why some oppression has happened and why some things haven't happened. So that's very important.
Well, thank you. I thank you all for listening to me, and please get on board with this campaign.
Okay, guys, take 10 minutes to stretch up, grab a snack. If you got coffee, grab some coffee. I'm going to be back again in 10 minutes.
Quick technical note. If anybody has a laptop which we can rig up with a VGA cable, that is the little blue three-row pins, that would be great. We're running out of computers to do stuff, but we were going to try Sam's, but it would be good to have a backup. So if you got an extra computer, that would be awesome if you could come and talk to us. Thank you.
So I just, can you run PowerPoint?
Yeah.
Oh, good. All right, let's try it then.
No, but I can put it on.
I passed out a copy of our open letter to Mark Dayton about the minimum wage. I hope everybody will sign it before they leave and give me a copy of it.
Dennis, Colleen, Sam, Marcus. I'm from the Popeye era, and there was like a cartoon where you see this, like a man, you know, and then as soon as you fed him with the coins, his arm comes around, boom, and knocks you down, you know, and somebody else comes and feeds the machine, and the arm comes around, and boom. That's what we're doing. The Koch brothers, these are PG, all of the Procter & Gamble products are owned by the Koch brothers. And every Target ad you open, all these, like Tide, I always use Tide to but that's, I'm feeding the Koch brothers, and then they're coming and just destroying us. Right, so we need to organize consumer networks and start with our progressive people to this, and we should send us a design where every name on any product, we have to have register their names with the Secretary of State. So you could always trace the parent company, any brand. We should be able to punch a button to go into the chair from the whole family and not buy that product.
I agree. There's also, you mean an app like on your cell phone, right? There's already one called Bicon.
I heard about Bicon. I tried to understand that, and I couldn't quite get the hang of it. But I thought,
It scans barcodes, and I mean, not just done like true products. Chase down those leads.
Projector set up for the third time. Yay! Alright, so you gotta like rotate over here. And then I'll try to like hang it off the side of the table here. And then, yeah. I wish we had the table the 9/11 people are on. It goes on this side. Yeah, I think we'll be able to do it. Yeah, as long as this computer works okay. I'm gonna like move this thing for a minute. Okie dokie. So I'm gonna stop the recording and roll it over for a minute, and stop and start it again.